Sweetheart, you look radiant. Give me your hand.
Which one?
It doesn't matter which. Just give me your hand, sweetheart, okay? But first, close your eyes.
I'm not falling for that again.
It's not like last time. Do you trust me?
Yeah.
Okay, there you go. Close your eyes. No peeking. Step up. There you go. Okay? You ready? Open your eyes. Wait a minute, you know what they say. Pick or it didn't happen. You ready? 3, 2.
You backed up on the cloud though, right?
No.
Hello, everybody. Welcome welcome to another edition of WWE's The Bump. It is a very exciting time because we are only 30 days away from WrestleMania weekend going Hollywood. By the way, that's where I live. I live in Hollywood. Matt, you are in Stamford, Connecticut. Ryan, you're in Connecticut. How's it going, guys?
That's great. I don't live in Hollywood. Kayla, I hope the weather just hangs in there a little bit for okay. I know it's been tough lately. Real tough out there. By the way, a couple of birthday wishes off the top. Hall of Famer Booker T, our great friend Big E. Happy birthday to them as we begin March and the road to WrestleMania, Kayla. The destination's getting that much closer.
One more birthday I'm going to throw out there. Emma, also big birthday. It is a big birthday month. So happy birthday to everyone. Like I said, we're all getting super pumped for WrestleMania. We are just a few, I guess, 4 weeks away. And we've all been watching every single week. We know people at home have been watching every single week. Ryan, how do people get involved throughout the show today to talk about their excitement leading up to one, I think, the biggest WrestleManias of all time?
Oh, no doubt about it. 30 days to WrestleMania, 30 times Kayla will remind us she lives in Hollywood. But if you're excited about all of that, any of it, and you should be excited about all of it, you know the deal. Hashtag WWE The Bump. Get in on the action for the next hour. You got questions for our guests. We got a lot already. Got comments. Are you in the YouTube chat? Because I'm in there, too. I'm going to be talking to you like I do every week throughout the next hour. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, like I just said. Hashtag WWE The Bump. Get in on the conversation. We have a loaded show today. Kayla, tell them more about it.
All right, let's talk about who's going to be on the show today. We want to preface this by saying we purposely are going to keep these two guests separate after what we saw happen at the Elimination Chamber, but we do have Finn Balor joining us of Judgment Day. He's made some recent strong statements. We know he's probably going to do the same here today. And, of course, our next guests, we're going to, again, keep them separate. We've got WWE Hall of Famer Beth Phoenix joining us discussing what's been going on between she, her husband, and Judgment Day. And also, we're celebrating Women's History Month. We do have a lot we want to get through, but also, as we always do, have to do every single week. What's been going down on Friday Night SmackDown and Monday Night Raw every single week, Matt? And again, let's talk about Monday because we saw history made in a big way this past week.
Yeah, history with a lot of important women from the past, present, and of course the future, because we go to the main event of Monday Night Raw. The WWE Women's Tag Team Championships were on the line. Dakota Kai, Io Sky defending against Becky Lynch and, of course, Lita. And it's always been about the numbers game for damage control. Well, look at this. Hall of Famer Trish Stratus going to come out to even the odds. Bayley been getting involved, as she has been doing, known to do in championship matches. Try to do so here again with Lita. And, well, Trish is going to defend her bestie. Team Bestie, we're doing yoga together all weekend, working out. Lita was ready to go for this one, and Trish going to help out. And as would Becky, because Becky right here is going to put Dakota in the disarmor on the outside while Lita hits her patented moonsault onto Io on the inside. And we have new WWE Women's Tag Team Champions, the Hall of Famer Lita, Becky Lynch, getting some help from another Hall of Famer in Trish Stratus. What a night on Monday Night Raw in Grand Rapids, Michigan. We have new tag team champions. The road to WrestleMania has lots of twists and turns. And Kayla, that was a big one on Monday Night Raw.
That's what you call making herstory. Get it?
Say it. I got it. Very good.
Okay, whatever. Well, listen, speaking of making herstory and the Women's Division, Women's History Month, next Wednesday is International Women's Day. We here on The Bump are going to celebrate in a big way with some legends. We have got Lita in studio in Stamford next week. Of course, she's going to be showing off her new gold, and also Liv Morgan, who has been very vocal about how much she's looked up to Lita throughout her career. Both of these iconic and incredible women will be live in The Bump studio next Wednesday. So make sure you do not miss out on any of that.
No, we're not going to miss out. I have spots ready for them to go, of course, right here in studio. Looking very much forward to all of that. And then, Kayla, on top of that news, we got to talk about what went down on Raw, because Cody Rhodes sent a message, but did so, of course, before he sent that message, he warmed up a bit with a, I guess, an iron sharpens iron kind of situation against Chad Gable on Monday Night Raw. You want to get ready for Roman Reigns? You want to get ready for WrestleMania? How about you take on a former Olympian in Chad Gable? Otis, who had his own things going on, gets deposited to the outside. Look at this Cody cutter right here. Boom! On Chad Gable, and right there, Cody was feeling it. Michigan was feeling it for Cody. And watch what happens to Chad Gable here, because this crossroads was brutal. And after the victory for Cody Rhodes, he would address his WrestleMania opponent.
I have yet to stand in the same ring as my opponent, our undisputed champion, Roman Reigns. But he is on SmackDown this Friday, and I am ecstatic that Roman Reigns is on SmackDown this Friday, because I'll be there too.
Woo-wee, I gotta say, this is one of those times I'm so thankful that I work on Friday Night SmackDown, because I'm excited to see all of this go down up close and personal. There you heard it for the first time. We're gonna see these two superstars come face to face. And there's no telling what's gonna happen, no telling what words are going to be exchanged, especially with the intensity being as high as it is only a month away from WrestleMania, Matt.
No doubt about that. And of course, we saw Jimmy Uso, as we go back to SmackDown last week, deciding when to address the issues with the Bloodline. Well, he would do so at the end of Friday night, which not only saw a surprise appearance from Jey Uso, but also an appearance from Sami Zayn as well. Let's take a look.
You so damn selfish. You want to blame me? You want to put the blame on me?
Just like I told Jey, there's a way out for you. You don't have to go down with the ship. And I'm looking in your eyes, and I know you know what I'm saying is true. And
Sammy trying to level with Jimmy. Jimmy's not going to have any of it. He's going to attack Sammy, as Sammy at the time was distracted by Jey Uso. And then Jimmy would get somewhat distracted by Jey coming down to ringside. A haluva kick there from Sammy. He's going to strike, and he's going to bail, because you know, of course, Solo Sikoa was not far behind. Sammy goes out a different way through the WWE Universe. As Jey watches on, that brings us to Monday, where we see Jimmy and Solo taking on the Street Profits. Now, obviously, the Usos have had their battles with the Profits in the past. Profits came out to kind of tell the Usos what was going on. Well, Solo didn't like any of it. Unfortunately for Angelo Dawkins, he met the wrong end of a Samoan spike by Solo Sikoa. But Solo was not done yet. They're trying to send strong messages ahead of WrestleMania. And Montez Ford was in big trouble. And then KO out of nowhere, gonna hit the super kick on Solo. Jimmy's gonna walk right into a stunner, and Kevin trying to continue to make that fracture in the Bloodline that much bigger as he hits and runs on Monday Night Raw.
Man.
Good. Ryan, as we saw that there and everything that went down, a lot of people, while you're seeing the Bloodline kind of say, hey, we're not fractured, it seems like they keep having to defend themselves verbally, or maybe, Ryan, to themselves.
Yeah, Matt, Kayla, what I think is interesting is that's almost as if Jimmy is trying to talk himself into the fractures not existing, which I don't know if that's ever a good look.
Sounds to me that they're also experiencing getting a taste of their own medicine after how they treated Sami Zayn. Didn't he say, just like last week, what does it mean when you have to constantly defend yourself to people that you're supposed to be family with? Well, listen, this is how it feels, buds. I got
you're
you, Sami.
Wrong.
Anyway, Ryan.
You know what's crazy about the road to WrestleMania is that we just touched on a lot of stuff, but we did not even scratch the surface on what happened in the last week in WWE. We have a host for WrestleMania. His name's The Miz, and he was very excited about it. Nate is very excited about it. The Miz hosting WrestleMania, I love it. You know who was also loving life this past Monday was Seth freaking Rollins, who was on Miz TV. He was loving life, though, for different reasons. Let's take a look at that right now.
Miz, stop calling me.
Surprise! I think we're all pretty sick of this game of cat and mouse you've been playing. So how about next week, you grow a set, show up on Raw, stand in this ring, and go face to face with Seth Rollins, baby!
I like the way that sounds. You got yourself a deal, pal. Man to man. And guess what? I would love to see you try to run your mouth when we are standing face to face, big man.
Oh, it's on, baby! Logan, one more thing. Bye-bye.
That soundbite took over the internet, but also Annette brings up here, Seth Rollins brought up Jake Paul losing to Logan. We love it, Seth. Seth was holding nothing back this past Monday. And then Fade says, Seth trolling Logan Paul is absolute cinema. Fitting because WrestleMania is going Hollywood. Talking about cinema, let's talk about Brock Lesnar on the MVP lounge. Brock just chilling and head bobbing to MVP's music. Everything, the vibes were great. MVP and Brock, ultimately they were accepting the challenge for Omos versus Brock at WrestleMania. But then, as we're going to see here, we're going to go one back because ultimately, take it from MVP, Allen says, do not spit in Brock Lesnar's face. It was an accident on MVP's part, but Brock didn't care. It was an F5, and then ultimately we will see if an F5 can happen to Omos at WrestleMania when these two behemoths collide. Let's talk about John Cena, because he's coming back this Monday night on Raw, and Realist here is super pumped. John Cena returns this Monday, March 6th, on Raw, and then that's all of us. We're just all perpetually excited about this. The only person who may not be is Austin Theory, because he still has John Cena's name in his mouth. And Ark here says, Austin Theory said he's going to give John Cena respect next week on Raw. It's going to be interesting. It really will be. When we're talking about respect, one person who doesn't have it for seemingly anyone, that's Dominic Mysterio. He started that disrespect with Charlotte this past Friday on SmackDown, and Simply Brutal says, Charlotte is owning Dom right now with this back and forth. I'm living for it. Dom cared not, though. We got a little bit more react here because Sydney says, I would love to see Charlotte beat Dom up. I would love that so much. Unfortunately, Charlotte has to focus on Rhea, not Dom, as we head to WrestleMania. And Dom, although with Charlotte, was also focusing on Rey Mysterio this past Friday, which really nobody was happy about, other than, again, maybe Dominic, because Rated R Grit here says, Rey does not deserve this, man. After all he's done for Dom, Dom treats him like this, which leads to reactions like these, which is that S is saying, one of these days, we will get Rey full on swinging for Dom, and that will be a great day. That day was not this past Friday. We will see when and if that day comes. Kayla.
Well, listen, Ryan, I'm glad you ended with Dominic there because it is time to bring on our first guest who has secured many accolades during his time here in WWE. He's a former Universal, NXT, US, and Intercontinental Champion. Recently, his group in Judgment Day just can't seem to shake former Judgment Day member Edge from his wrath, but he has doled out a lot of wrath in his own right. He also has a match coming up this Monday on Raw against his old and familiar foe, Johnny Gargano. Let's please welcome to the show, Finn Balor.
I don't need a welcome. Thank you very much. I've already expressed the fact that I hate this show. I hate being invited on this show. I hate the fact that I have to use my day off to come online and talk to you guys about absolute rubbish that I should have dealt with last Monday and I'll deal with next Monday. So if we can just keep this interview moving as quick as we can so I can get back to normal life.
So I'll skip the question asking how you are, how happy you are to be on our show today. So moving on, we are very happy that you are back here. As always, a pleasure talking to you. But let's go ahead and get right into things, especially the big news coming out of Raw. Before we talk about it, let's all watch it back real quick.
Edge, my old friend.
You thought this was over at Elimination Chamber?
Edge and Beth Phoenix, the last couple standing.
You don't get to decide when this is over. This is over when I say it's over.
The Judgment Day isn't fading into the rearview mirror.
You see, Edge, you are playing checkers. The Prince, he's playing chess.
Balor with a third coup de grace.
And there's still one more move. So if you accept my challenge, I end this at WrestleMania.
Oh, yeah.
Check it.
Woo! All right, so we're going to get to talking about how we all got to this point. But as we just saw, you threw out this challenge to Edge for WrestleMania. So how important is it that you finish this once and for all and it to be on your terms?
Well, Kayla, how can a Hall of Famer possibly be satisfied with that victory at Elimination Chamber when clearly Edge used his wife for the assistance. Let's not even start talking about the shoddy refereeing by WWE official Eddie Arango. It's clearly a disqualification. Beth used that stupid move to injure my ribs, to help Edge defeat Finn. He cannot do it one-on-one.
And, you know, Finn, you've been a part of Judgment Day for the last, you know, 8 or 9 months, but you've been embroiled in this thing with Edge for quite a bit longer. And considering everything that's transpired over time, all the people who have been involved, did you say that this has gotten to be more of a personal vendetta than anything?
Yeah, I think this started out as a group issue between the Judgment Day and Edge, and basically the fact that these so-called legends and so-called Hall of Famers like to tell the younger generation what to do and how to act and how to behave. And I feel like in recent months, this has really turned into a personal issue between me and Edge, of a clash of opinions, a clash of styles, a clash of what we believe in. And I feel like this needs to be settled one-on-one, man-on-man at WrestleMania. If Edge chooses to accept, I will end this.
Finn, if Edge accepts, this will be your third match at WrestleMania. How does this feel different compared to your previous two Mania matches, which have been centered around the Intercontinental Championship?
It'll feel a lot different than last WrestleMania when, while WrestleMania was happening, I went to watch Batman because I wasn't involved in the show. So I'm definitely going to take full advantage of the fact that if he accepts, which he should being a man, that I will punish him, I will end him, and it will be Edge's last WrestleMania.
Ooh. I could tell you, you're motivated by a lot of things, not only Edge, but you and Edge have never really crossed paths in any way before last year and really haven't spent a lot of time together in WWE at the same time. As someone who mostly observed Edge from afar before last year, what stood out to you about him as a superstar?
He certainly has a connection with the WWE Universe. He certainly has a love and a passion for this business. He's resilient in the sense that he's retired and returned to the ring. But that return is going to be short-lived because I think it was about a year and a half ago at Royal Rumble he returned. And his second retirement will be at WrestleMania.
Ooh, all right, so you definitely have some strong words and opinions and, I guess, predictions when it comes to what's going on between you and Edge, and we're all going to definitely anxiously await what he has to say. But before you get to Edge, you encountered an old foe on Raw. Let's take a look.
Yeah.
Johnny, Otis is going to flatten you like a pancake tonight. And if, by some miracle, he doesn't cover you in maple syrup and gobble you all up, trust me, next week, I'll finish the job myself.
Sounds delicious. I'll see you next week.
You're just going after everyone. So this will be the first time in 3 years that you'll be back in the ring with Johnny Gargano. How much does, you know, the past that you two have kind of tie into you really wanting this match next week?
Myself and Johnny don't really have much of a past apart from the NXT TakeOver match at Portland, Oregon, where I defeated Johnny there. I'm going to defeat him again this Monday. It was a little surprising that he actually managed to squeak past Otis last Monday. But trust me, I'm going to finish the job this week in Boston.
Let's talk about the past, because it was, Finn, a swift kick to Johnny's head back in October of 2019 was a big part of your return to NXT and the subsequent battles you had. Of course, you mentioned TakeOver. You wrestled at Super Tuesday for the NXT Championship. But, you know, this was a huge match here. This is two pillars of NXT facing off. You mentioned getting the victory here. How did the return to NXT in this run help you evolve to the Finn Balor we see today on Monday Night Raw?
I think every time we step out from behind the curtain, we evolve as performers. And obviously that was a very rich and very rich time of growth for me personally. I kind of got to shed a lot of the things that I was doing perhaps for other people and not for myself. And I feel like I became more of a true version of Finn when I returned to NXT. And I've managed to carry that forward going into the Judgment Day. And I feel like what you're seeing now isn't an act or isn't a gimmick. It's just the person that you're speaking to.
Finn, I'm going to kick it back to you and Edge, because what's interesting about you and Edge is that it's extending past the ring. It's extending onto social media. This past weekend, you posted this. It's a picture of you and Austin Theory in the gym. Didn't mention Edge, didn't talk about Edge. Edge replied with this comment right here saying, "Wow, you guys stand around the gym with your shirts off. Super cool." Again, you did not invoke Edge's name. What do you make of something like this from your perspective?
Yeah, Ryan, I'm not sure. Did you see my reply to that message?
Tell the audience. I did, but feel free.
I didn't reply because it's absolutely pointless. If he wants to talk trash on Twitter like a child, he can. But when you're dealing with Finn Balor, you got to deal with me in the ring. He had to deal with me in Ottawa last week, and we all saw how that happened. So when Edge decides to return to Raw, decides to return his big, giant, oversized head to television, I will climb up on the top rope, I will jump as high as I can, and I will crush him.
Ooh.
Swiftly, smoothly, and with precise precision.
That says a lot right there. To that point, though, this is Edge's profile picture right now on Twitter, Finn, and I feel like it kind of plays into what you're saying. It's this picture from of him chasing you. Finn, do you feel as though Edge, and again, what you just said is super strong words, but do you feel as though Edge is trying to have a little too much fun at your expense?
You know what? I feel like he is having a lot of fun. And just that picture that you just showed when he chased me down the aisle of the Royal Rumble. Look at this. I've still got a scar here. I don't know if you can see that.
Oh dear.
A big scar from where I tripped.
Ow.
I tripped on it. The only reason Edge caught me that night, because I'm a very fast runner, but I swear I tripped on a camera cable. A cameraman was trying to get a shot of me running swiftly away from Edge. I tripped on the cable, and that's the only reason Edge caught me that night. I'm telling you, if Edge wants to race anywhere, any place, 100 meters, I will burn him out.
Well, I'll throw it out to the WWE-verse right now. Who do you think is going to win in a race, Edge or Finn? Finn feels very confident. I totally understand. I respect it. Finn, we're going to get some more fan sentiment here. We got a lot of fan questions for you. You won't be surprised by that. You just mentioned wanting to hit the coup de grace on Edge. Matt wants to know, who's your favorite opponent you have ever hit the coup de grace on, ever in history? Is it Edge?
Ooh. God, I hit three of them on Edge. I hit one on Brock Lesnar. I hit a couple on Johnny Gargano. God, you take your pick. I've pretty much hit it on everyone. Roman Reigns was a good one. Seth Rollins is a good one. I haven't hit it on Cody Rhodes yet.
Oh wow.
Ooh.
So that's one that's certainly in the future.
All right, I'm just going to let that sit there. That says a lot. We're going to move on to this next question from Jordan, who asked, Finn, we got this one a lot. I felt like we had to ask it. It's from Jordan. Are you planning on getting any new members in the Judgment Day sometime in the future?
We are always planning. The Judgment Day are always planning. We're always plotting. We're always scheming. I'm always texting with Damian. We have a group chat with me, Damian, Rhea, Dom. We're plotting. We're figuring things out. And trust me, once we get Mania behind us, the Judgment Day will be expanding.
Wow.
Oh.
Oh.
Wow. Wow. All right.
Check your LinkedIn.
Yeah. Thanks, Kayla. Thanks, Kayla. One more. This is from Panda. Kayla's going to talk more about this in a second. But Panda wants to know, your fashion sense has really taken over social in recent months, Finn. You know that. Are bandanas better than bucket hats? Panda wants to know, Finn.
God. I do love my bucket hat, but I feel like the bandana is so versatile that if I was to make a choice, I would go with the bandana.
Wow.
All right. Well, listen, as Ryan mentioned, you do tend to evolve your look, especially on your interests throughout your career. And something that stood out as of late are these blinding masks that you've been wearing to the ring. We want to find out a little bit more of the story behind them, starting with the one that you wore for Extreme Rules last year. So how did this come to life? This is awesome. Look, Doja Cat wore something similar on the red carpet recently in red, but this is, you are the trendsetter here, Finn.
Yeah, it's just something that I wanted to try out and experiment with. I always feel like that if you have an idea, you should dive into it head first. I've had plenty of ideas before. Bullet Club, that was pretty successful. The demon character, that was pretty successful. Mm-hmm. So this idea of, you know, covering my face covering, you know, what people associate with you, that image, that visual representation can perhaps change the demeanor of, you know, the silhouette that they're seeing. And that was kind of the idea behind it. And that's why I've been experimenting with it.
I love that. So you're kind of telling people what they need to see based on what you're wearing. We have another one that you brought out about a month later at Survivor Series. I want to talk about this one here. What does this one symbolize?
Yeah, it's just basically like taking the facial image away. So, you know, you can't really see any emotion, can't see any reaction or any excitement that's under there. And it's basically like playing poker with your opponents before the match, you know, keeping a poker face.
Yeah, I think that's way more intimidating than even seeing somebody's face 100%. Because, yeah, you don't know what's under there. You don't know what to expect. You don't know the emotions behind it. So, yeah, I think it's brilliant.
It's working out quite nicely for your fit. Now, one time we see all of your emotions is when you are hyping up one Dominic Mysterio. That has been very apparent. I think you're not only a mentor, but I feel like you're his personal hype man. What is it like being right there to see his transformation since he's been part of the Judgment Day?
You know, it's kind of makes me sad a little bit that Dominic hasn't received the support from his family. The fact that he's growing and achieving so much in such a short time, but without that, you know, backbone of family support, is quite incredible. And but at the same time, you know, my family have always supported me, so, you know, I take that kind of for granted, that people should be supported by their families. And the fact that, you know, Ray has continuously you know, not shown support, not shown interest in his son's development and career is quite saddening. So, you know, myself, Damien, and Rhea have both all been a shoulder for Dom to lean on. And I think he's stepped out of his father's shadow in such a short time. And I think he's going to make his father pay.
Oh, well, you know, he was there on SmackDown last week. We'll talk about Rhea with you in just a second. And had a little moment there with Ray. Ray didn't want to hit him just yet. And I asked Dom this at Elimination Chamber. I said, can you repair this? Can you repair this father-son relationship? He said no. Finn, does that make you the only family that Dom has right now?
He's got family in me. He's got family in Damien. And he's got a mommy and a Rhea. So he's got plenty of family. He's got plenty of support. And trust me, he's a big boy now. And he's going to show his daddy who's boss.
Oh, well, he also confronted the Queen Charlotte Flair last week on SmackDown. And, of course, Rhea would join him before that got physical. What kind of personal pride do you have from seeing Rhea venture off to SmackDown to challenge Charlotte for the SmackDown Women's Championship at WrestleMania?
It was only a matter of time before Rhea began to pursue gold in this company. Obviously, she had a huge night at the Royal Rumble and made the Judgment Day incredibly proud. We all support her in her quest to become SmackDown Women's Champion, and that will be at the expense of Charlotte Flair. I know Charlotte's very experienced, probably the most experienced female competitor in all of wrestling history, not even WWE. But she is going in there with a force of Rhea. Rhea's got this X factor that is indescribable. She's in the moment, in this moment in her career, I feel like she has all the momentum behind her. And she has that kind of raw, unplucked energy that is going to take her over the line at WrestleMania and make her the new champion.
All right. Well, listen, before we let you go, we are going to ask you to send some parting words to Edge. But before we do that, his wife, Beth Phoenix, is waiting in the wings. I know that she has been watching this interview. So is there any message, though, that you would like for us to relay to Beth for when she does come on? Anything you want us to tell her?
Please tell Beth that the next time she dares smash her knees into my chest in a wrestling ring, Rhea will make her pay.
And anything that you want to say to Edge?
Edge, if you want to tweet me or Instagram message me or text me or DM me or FaceTime me, I won't pick up, I won't reply, and I won't answer. Come see me face to face like a man, and we'll handle this one on one.
All right. Wow. Well, Finn, thank you.
Are we done?
Always.
Are we done, Kayla?
We're done. I'll let you go. That's it.
I'm done.
We'll get you again.
Hey,
what? The same time next month?
This is two times this year, by the way. No. This is two times this year already, and you only had one. So you got to save it for 2024. Is that it?
That was last calendar year. This is this one.
No,
okay. Well, we're done for now.
Okay, we'll
email you with your next appearance. Thanks,
Ben. Matt, Ryan, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Nice to see you guys. Bye-bye. Toodaloo. Adios.
Bye.
He's leaving.
Whoa, he's such a ball of joy, I guess, right? Well, I'm excited. I'm really interested to hear what Beth has to say to everything that just happened. And what she does, you want to see her in a little bit. But guys, we said it before, we are about a month away from WrestleMania. And as we've talked about, there already are some confirmed matches on the cards. And we're going to do something new right here in the middle of our interviews, Matt. We're going to kind of talk about and break down some of these confirmed matches. So let's go ahead and start with one that we just talked about. That is Charlotte and Rhea.
I got a lot of numbers when it comes to these matches. I want to start with Charlotte Flair. This will be her seventh WrestleMania match and her seventh WrestleMania match with a championship involved. 4-2 at WrestleMania when it comes to Charlotte's record. That's unbelievable. And this will be a rematch. This will be Rhea's fourth match at WrestleMania. Also, all championships involved. She is 1-2 in WrestleMania matches, but this is different for both of them. This is a different Rhea Ripley than the one Charlotte Flair faced and beat for the NXT Championship 3 years ago, of course, at WrestleMania 36. This is a Rhea Ripley who has done more, not necessarily in the ring, but outside of the ring. And the confidence of Rhea and the confidence that has passed on to Dominic Mysterio and the Judgment Day being as successful as they have been hasn't always been about Rhea being in matches, but being an X factor. But now the spotlight is firmly on her. The Royal Rumble victory, challenging Charlotte Flair, wanting to erase in her mind the loss from a few years ago, and getting a Charlotte Flair who is as confident as ever. The numbers in this one are very intriguing, but will it be Rhea finally getting that elusive victory over Charlotte Flair, Kayla? That is the question.
All right, well, let's talk about another one, Matt, that was made just this past Monday night between these two behemoths of superstars, talking about Omos and Brock Lesnar.
Well, I want to start with Omos here because you think about what he's done at WrestleMania. He's won the Raw Tag Team Championships in his debut a couple of years ago. Last year was in there against Bobby Lashley. That set him off a very different path. But now he's in there against someone who is synonymous in WrestleMania history, and I'm talking about Brock Lesnar. You want to talk about moments? There is going to be a moment in Hollywood when these two behemoths, the Nigerian giant, the beast Brock Lesnar, when they have that face-to-face moment, if they even have one, because they might tear the whole place apart before we can get that moment, but when they step face-to-face in the middle of that ring at SoFi Stadium, that's as big as anything you will ever see, quite literally. Brock has F5'd anybody that's been in his path. Can he do it to Omos, or can Omos earn the biggest victory of his career by defeating Brock Lesnar? Kayla, you gotta love the confidence of Omos for him to be the one to throw this challenge out there.
And it is going to be one massive challenge for them both. Well, let's talk about, we're only a couple weeks removed from the Elimination Chamber, which is where Asuka secured her opportunity to take on Raw Women's Champion Bianca Belair at WrestleMania. Matt, what do you think is going to happen between these two women?
Well, listen, Bianca, as I talked about so much in her second reign as a singles champion WWE, the confidence has been there. She's faced all kinds of adversity and different opponents, and whether it be mind games or physical battles or, you know, getting revenge and, you know, things she went through with Alexa Bliss, things that she's gone through with Bayley, things that she's gone through with Becky Lynch. This is going up against an opponent here in Asuka who has kind of been rejuvenated, reinvented herself, pulled some of the past of Asuka, nearly won her the Royal Rumble, does win her the Elimination Chamber, and it's felt like the last couple of weeks, whether it be the Blue Mist or the Goo, that's kind of messed with Bianca just a little bit there. But here's the bottom line. When Asuka steps between those ropes, there may be no one better. When she is on her game, there may be no one better. Now, you can say Asuka, WrestleMania past, she's had some struggles. She's lost to Charlotte. She lost to Rhea Ripley. I think that's been weighing on her, and I think Bianca, not only with the mind games, has to think about the fact that Asuka is looking for that massive victory at WrestleMania, and if Bianca's not careful, Asuka may get it, of course, in Hollywood.
All right, and one more, the match that everybody is anticipating since his return last year, Cody Rhodes and Roman Reigns.
It seems odd to me that Roman Reigns knows he is facing Cody Rhodes for the undisputed WWE Universal Championship, and he's not really talking about Cody Rhodes. He's dealing with Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens and where Jey Uso stands in the bloodline. He has Jimmy. He's got the wise man, Paul Heyman. He's got Solo Sikoa, but he's trying to repair. He's trying to pretend like he's not, and I'm sure he'll try to get everybody back together this Friday when he's back on SmackDown, and that won't be for them. That won't be for him. He knows he needs to have all the soldiers lined up. He's got to have the bloodline ready to go because he has a challenge in Cody Rhodes and a challenge that goes back nearly 50 years when you think about the Rhodes family to finish the story and finish the job. Cody has been hyper-focused since winning the Royal Rumble on this championship match. We didn't know if it would be Sami or Roman. We know it's Roman right now, and Cody has kept that focus. And for the first time, Kayla, we're going to see these two in the same place at the same time on Friday at SmackDown with a month still to go before they meet at WrestleMania.
All right, Matt, thanks so much. Again, that's four matches that are already confirmed for WrestleMania, but we know there are two big nights of WrestleMania Saturday and Sunday. So make sure everyone is keeping your eyes and ears peeled over the next several weeks on both Raw and SmackDown to see what else we have to look forward to. But here's something to look forward to on Sunday. We are bringing back a little A&E this Sunday. WWE Superstar Sunday is once again coming to you March the 5th. Here's a little look at what you can expect.
She set the table for every woman that came after her.
Sunday.
It's always been my destiny.
But she spun into a downward spiral.
WWE Legends China.
The news came in, I burst into tears.
And then
John Cena and The Rock.
WWE Rivals.
This is what happens when idiots have confidence.
Here we go!
This will be a story of multiple perspectives. Get ready.
WWE Superstar Sunday continues Sunday starting at 8, only on A&E.
That's right, Biography. WWE Legends tells the intimate personal stories behind the success of some of WWE's most memorable legends and events. This weekend's episode features the ninth wonder of the world, China. And immediately following a biography, WWE Legends is an all-new WWE Rivals at 10, 9 Central featuring John Cena versus The Rock. All right, we're going to send things back to Ryan on the social set for a question that we threw out to all of you ahead of this big event.
Yeah, thank you, Kayla. Ahead of WWE Superstar Sunday, what we thought could be fun to focus in on that Rivals episode would be to throw it out to the WWE Universe. When we were in the thick of once in a lifetime between Rock and John Cena, were you Team Cena or you Team Rock? Let's get those answers right now. It's going to be interesting. 53% lean Team Cena over Team Rock. A nail biter, that's as close as it can get just about, but very, very interesting. Again, that's WWE Rivals this Sunday, 10, 9 Central, a part of Superstar Sunday on A&E, Kayla. Close one.
All right, Ryan. I know that is very close. All right, well, it is now time to bring on our next guest, who again, who has been patiently waiting in the rings and probably having to tolerate the interview we just did prior to hers. But we are so pumped that she's here to help us celebrate the start of Women's History Month. But she's also someone who has won four championships in her time here in WWE. She was inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame in 2017. Here's a fun fact. She and her husband, Edge, are the only husband and wife duo in the prestigious Hall of Fame. And even though they are in the Hall of Fame, doesn't mean they aren't still kicking ass and taking names every single week. Beth Phoenix, join us now. Hello.
Hello. Hey, I also got to mention,
Booker T and Charmel joined us as a married Hall of Fame couple as
yes,
well.
Yes,
so
yes,
we gotta
you're absolutely right.
We got to give props to Booker and Charmel.
You are absolutely
great
right.
Company.
I'm sorry, we're going to correct
company.
That. Beth, thank you so much for joining us. How are you doing this morning?
I'm doing great. I had a big day of momming, and I'm so excited to be back in the bump. I feel like it's been too long. I've been waiting for that phone call.
You can literally come on every single week, and no one's going to have one complaint about that. But we are very happy that you are here. Like I said, it is the start of Women's History Month, so it's only appropriate to have someone who has been as influential as you. And, you know, you're one of those names that comes up when we talk to other up-and-coming and current women superstars of who they looked up to during their journey through WWE. But I want to ask you the same question. When looking back at women that you looked up to in your career, is there anyone that comes to mind?
Yeah, I mean, we just saw the promotional package for the biography on China. I think like she was one of the biggest influences for me on the type of persona and image I wanted to put out there. But I have to call back to some of the women that inspired me as a really young wrestling fan, like Bull Nakano, whom I paid homage to this at the Elimination Chamber with the face paint, who represented just something that I'd never seen before, a different body type, a different aggressive Japanese wrestling style in the ring. And I think Bull Nakano is somebody that definitely belongs in the WWE Hall of Fame. Luna Vachon, like Sherry Martel, Alundra Blaze, women that stood out to me as fierce and competitive and were hanging just like the guys in the ring. Those are the ones that I would immediately name that come forward to me as inspiration.
You know, I think that's really great. Also, I think what's really special and unique about, you know, your career here in WWE is that you have been able to be a part of so many different generations of women superstars. And so how cool has that been for you to be able to kind of cross over into multiple generations? And again, you're still hanging with the best of them every single week.
Yeah, I think it's been incredible. Like, just my age bracket, I kind of came in real young. I was 24, 25 when I came into WWE. So I was able to bridge several generations. I came in just at the end. I got to work with Trish Stratus a little bit and the women that have come before me. And then also learn, sit at the table and learn from a lot of previous superstars. Medusa was somebody, Alundra Blaze was somebody that took some time to talk to me in the beginning. And even, you know, Mae Young, I wrestled Mae Young, you know? So when we talk about like, of being able to span, I've wrestled Mae Young and I've wrestled 25-year-old Rhea Ripley. So there's this awesome breadth of diversity in between from all the talent, the incredible talent that I've got to work with over the years.
And you're such an incredible example, Beth, because here you are, you're giving credit to where it's due, you're giving credit to the women that you looked up to, and you're giving credit to the superstars of today. But, you know, when I talked about earlier how these, especially NXT, Raw, SmackDown, these women look up to you and they talk about how you have been such an influence. What does that mean to you, you know, on a personal level?
I mean, it means everything to me, especially since I had a lot of intimate time in NXT, getting to know everybody and getting to really try to help everybody cultivate their best self and grow and find what's going to work for them on the main roster and you know, really come forth as a superstar. And I feel like I got to watch a lot of that. I felt like almost like Auntie. I always call myself Auntie Beth because I just felt like I was pulling men and women so much and wanting to see them, you know, get their WrestleMania matches and see their dreams achieved. As a mom, I feel like that's just inherent in me to just want to see these young folks succeed. So it means the world to me that they would consider me any sort of inspiration or influence. I hope that, you know, they could take something positive from the work that I've put out there.
Has there been anything specifically, or maybe even anyone specifically of this current generation of WWE superstars, especially in the women's division, that has specifically impressed you, caught your eye?
Oh, I mean, there's so many. I mean, I'd kind of pluck, if I were to just, this is going to put me on the spot because I could be here all day, but like Piper Niven is somebody that when I saw her in the Mae Young Classic, and I just saw the level of athleticism that she was capable of. I was like, this girl's a star. And I mean, and I sound like a broken record here, but Bianca Belair, you know, Candice LeRae, Io Shirai, you know, and as much as this kills me inside, Rhea Ripley is a new breed, a new generation. She is a like, you know, as I heard Finn saying earlier, she's just a force of nature. And there's no denying it. As we see the women move toward the future, I love that they're taking elements of previous generations and evolving it to what we have now, which is the greatest women's division in the entire world.
No doubt about it, Beth. And you mentioned Finn. I want to get to what he said directly to you in just a little bit, but we saw it on Raw. He puts out the challenge to Edge for WrestleMania. What was your immediate impression as to that challenge from Finn?
Oh, I mean, of course, that's instantly where he's going to go, because I think Finn got embarrassed. He got physically hurt. I mean, I think he encountered, he went through a lot of emotions after our elimination chamber match. So I'm not surprised at all that the first thing to come out of his mouth, because as we know, Finn likes to talk. Mm-hmm. He's a big talker, mm-hmm. was to come out and challenge Adam. This is not new. The Judgment Day has been a thorn in Adam's side for nearly a year. And I was not surprised at all that it's coming to a head, coming to this.
Well, as we said, he did have a message for you, for those who may have missed it. Let's take a look at that real quick right now.
Please tell Beth that the next time she dares smash her knees into my chest in a wrestling ring, Rhea will make her pay.
Beth, this is Finn's. This is his favorite show. He loves coming on here. I'm sure he's still watching. Would you like to retort to Finn right now?
Yeah, I mean, that sounded like an invitation for me to smash my knees into his chest again, first of all, which I would gladly do. I had so much fun the first time, and I'll do it anytime. It doesn't have to be in a wrestling ring. But if he wants to sick Rhea Ripley on me, he should know that I'm ready for that. And as Rhea said before, there's unfinished business there.
Well, and that's it. You know, Finn clearly sees an unfinished business. He's still ready to, again, keep going after Edge. But how certain were you after your victory elimination chamber that this was over between you and Judgment Day?
I mean, I felt pretty good about it. I mean, we came away with a victory, and I think we did it decisively. I laid out Rhea Ripley with a glam slam on the floor, which if Rhea's smart, she never wants to encounter that again. She never wants to be put up in that double chicken wing, because she knows when she goes down, that's the end of it, and she's not getting back up. So to me, I felt really confident that Adam and I walked away the victors, and we embarrassed them like they tried to do for the entire year.
Well, unfortunately, it's not over. Maybe for us, I'm happy to see it. But I want to ask you this, because I guess Beth the superstar and Beth the mom and wife, maybe they're all mixed together. Are you concerned with everything that's happened between Edge and Finn and Judgment Day and yourself, where this level of destruction could go to if this match goes down to WrestleMania?
You know, one thing's for certain, and I'll say this, is my husband, Adam, he is the toughest, the most resilient, the grittiest man I know. And I know that right now, where Finn Balor's headspace is, this is gonna go to a place between him and Adam. It's gonna be between Finn and Adam. And if Rhea Ripley wants to stick her nose in there, I think she's learned her lesson. But if she decides to, then I'm there. But for the most part, I'm gonna leave this to Adam, because I know he's gonna have something to say.
Well, this all started because Edge started Judgment Day almost around this time last year, WrestleMania, obviously what he went through with AJ Styles, then Damian, and then Rhea Ripley came on board. We know how things changed when Finn kind of flipped with it all. How did you feel initially about Edge forming the Judgment Day?
I mean, the idea came from, you know, Adam has this opportunity now, the last 3 years of his career coming back to WWE. He wanted to pass along some of the 30 years of knowledge of equity. Talk about a generational superstar, you know, having wrestled Terry Funk, Kurt Hennig, Jerry Lawler, you name it. Adam's wrestled everybody spanning, you know, several generations. So he wanted to give that to folks that he knew would take that knowledge and take that all of that information and use it in the best way possible, and give them a platform, give them the attention, give them the guidance. And unfortunately, they thought they knew it all. So in the beginning, I thought that this was a great idea. I thought that, you know, that these incredible, talented people that I've known since NXT would take to this like ducks to water. But unfortunately, they had other plans, and it became a rocky road along the way because they decided to turn on Edge.
Beth, you talk about how Edge has taken on everybody from so many generations, which is true, but I got to tell you, the YouTube chat has not stopped bugging out about the fact that you've wrestled Mae Young and Rhea Ripley. All of our minds are just totally blown. I never conceptualized that. It's actually insane. Let's get off the Judgment Day for just a second, but let's stay at Elimination Chamber. You mentioned Bull Nakano a minute ago. On a very show full of social moments, that tribute you paid to her was as social a moment as we had. A two-part question, first part being, when did you come up with the idea to pay tribute to her that night?
I had, at Royal Rumble, I had paid tribute to Luna Vachon, whom I also was inspired by, and I just thought she was a badass woman. So I had this opportunity. I don't know how many more opportunities I have in the future to perform in WWE. So I just thought I had to take this moment as a childhood hero of mine to just bring forth Bull Nakano's work and how fabulous she was and what a trailblazer she was, especially now that we have so many amazing Japanese wrestlers working for us in WWE. I just think Bull Nakano needs her flowers.
Absolutely, no doubt about it. And then it spoke to a lot of people, and I know you know this. I really am curious about the answer. Bull said that she dug it. She loved the look. What's that like for you in the aftermath of the Elimination Chamber to go online and see that she said, yeah, that was awesome that Beth did that?
Oh, man, I was totally fangirling. It was so cool. And I actually had the opportunity to meet Bull Nakano once when I was working in Japan. So it was wonderful to hear from her and to know that, that tribute to her came straight from my heart.
It was awesome. Let's stay with good vibes at Elimination Chamber because obviously everything in the ring was quite contentious. But you took this picture with Natalya and Raquel with the amazing caption of Femalition, and then you'll see yourself out. You touched on this a little bit earlier too, that you've been able to, as we just mentioned with May and Rhea, been able to, you know, share the ring with so many different generations. But on a career night like that for you, which Elimination Chamber, you're teaming with your husband, it's a big stakes match. How cool is it to be able to share moments like that with multiple generations, with friends like Natalya and someone you've mentored? And Raquel.
Listen, Natalya has been my ride or die, my best friend for 20 some years. When I have to prepare or do something that I feel unconfident about, or I'm not sure, can I do this? Can I still go? The first person I call is always Natty. I mean, I call Natty all the time, but like when I call her and I need help, the first thing she does is drop everything and get my butt in the ring and beat me up. And in this instance, because we knew that Rhea was going to be the biggest challenge possibly of my entire career. So we're like, you know what? I need to get in there and I need to work with Raquel Gonzalez because Raquel has the stature, the power, and she also happens to have a friendship with Rhea. So I thought maybe I could dig for a couple secrets in there to give me a competitive edge. But it was phenomenal to get to work behind the scenes with Raquel, to get in the ring with her. I can't say enough good things about her potential as a future superstar, what she's doing now. But I got to tell you, Natty has gotten me ready to go every single time. Again, I have to mention generational talents. Natty's wrestled them all right alongside with me. And she's another woman, as we talk about Women's History Month, that I just want to bring forward and celebrate.
Totally agree. Beth, you had no idea at the time. That picture is a perfect segue to this fan question, which is a great question, but it's very difficult, I think. Matt Dave wants to know, who are your current top three female superstars, and which one would you team up with to face the other two with? This is a great question, but it's a hard question.
Who are the top three female superstars? Oh my God. Well, Becky Lynch. You've got to put Becky Lynch in that top three just because she might be the most versatile female superstar of all time. She's compelling. She's got that grit, which I love. You know, like Becky has fought through injury. We've seen it on screen. So I got to go with Becky. I'm going to put Bianca Belair in there because she's just undeniable. Like, she is a freak athlete in every sense of the word. And gosh, I got to pick somebody from the SmackDown side as well. You know who I'm going to go with? I'm going to go with Liv Morgan. I have wrestled Liv Morgan, and I know she has a bigger heart than almost any female I know. She loves wrestling and loves being a superstar. So I'm going to put her in the top three category just for pure heart. And then I have to pick two opponents or who I would tag team with.
Who would you team with? Yeah, Matt wants to know who you would team with out of those three. All good choices.
You know what? Any three of them would be a spectacular tech team. But I have to show loyalty to Natty. We're the DOD, and we keep it real. So if I don't have Natty in my corner, it's really hard to team with anybody else.
Say no more. And also, obviously, Liv Morgan will be with us next week. And then, Beth, one more. You touched on this a little bit. It's going to be even more specific, though, from Aaron Davies. If Rhea Ripley overcomes Charlotte at WrestleMania, then do you, Beth, plan on defeating Rhea once again to win the SmackDown Women's Championship? Obviously, we don't know how that match is going to shake out, but do you have just in the back of your mind that in your sights potentially?
Oh my gosh. I mean, I think ideally, like I'm pulling for Rhea Ripley. Like after our matchup, I feel like she's on the biggest role of her life. Personal issues aside, I think that we're going to see the best of Charlotte Flair versus the best of Rhea Ripley. I think that these past several years of growth have been amazing for Rhea. I was in the front row watching Rhea Ripley defeat Asuka at WrestleMania. I was sitting beside Raquel Gonzalez, and I was cheering just as hard as everybody else. I've wanted to see Rhea become this Rhea. And, you know, I can't say what the future brings, but I can tell you that an opportunity like that to face Rhea Ripley for the SmackDown Women's Championship would be a dream come true.
And you know, I want to keep talking about Rhea, you know, considering the fact that Edge is the one who initially brought Rhea Ripley into Judgment Day. So did that put you into contact with her in those early, in that short period? Were there, you know, conversations between the two of you?
Yeah, of course. I think, you know, Adam had talked to me, like, what on the female side of things, like, who do you think of the female roster, like, who could really benefit from having a bigger platform? Like, who needs it? Who has all of that talent, but just hasn't had the opportunity to shine it in a big way? And, you know, we had many discussions about that. And, watching Rhea grow in NXT, I've seen her since day one when she came in the Mayan Classic and, you know, struggled with comparisons to Charlotte Flair. And I watched Rhea shake that off day after day, match after match, and evolve into the current incarnation, her final form, the Nightmare, you know. And we just knew. We knew she's special. You know, as much as I hate to agree with Finn Balor, she is special. She's a one of a kind. And I know that her match at WrestleMania is main event worthy, obviously.
No doubt about it. Beth, and you and I talked about, you know, the interactions you had with Rhea and calling her matches at NXT and getting to see her up and close and personal. And then you got in the ring with her and you came out victorious in the mixed tag match at Elimination Chamber. You mentioned pulling for Rhea. You've been in there with her at Chamber. You, I think, only had one interaction with Charlotte back at Rumble 2020. So you're pulling for Rhea. But who wins the match at WrestleMania if you had to make a pick right now?
Yeah, you know, Charlotte and I have sparsely gotten to go toe-to-toe, just a teeny-weeny bit. But, yeah, she, you know, I think this is a giant mental test for Rhea. She absolutely has all of the physical skills. But as Charlotte Flair has said, and I think this is absolutely true, she's the opportunity. Charlotte Flair is the opportunity. And Rhea struggled the last time these two met. And I think that this is a different Rhea Ripley, but this is a different Charlotte Flair. Charlotte Flair is savvy. Charlotte Flair knows to pick and choose her opportunities, as we saw the way she came back and defeated Ronda Rousey. So, you know, I think that in this moment, I think that I am pulling for Rhea to kind of write her path from before when she maybe wasn't prepared as she should be. Now she knows what she's walking into. She knows exactly what she's facing. She knows the to not underestimate Charlotte Flair. And so I just know I'm going to be eating popcorn again watching this match. It's going to be phenomenal. And, you know, let's not forget, I speared the tar out of Rhea Ripley at the Royal Rumble. I gave her everything I got. Yes. Then she entered at number one, and she ran the gamut all the way. She lasted. She was the Iron Woman, despite me doing my best to break her ribs. So I think that Rhea Ripley is made of something special, and I think that Charlotte Flair will be the opportunity for Rhea to show that she is the top woman in WWE.
I love it. You know, it's just really cool to see also just how far these women have come, again, to be here at WrestleMania. I know you've been watching. Actually, over here to my right, I have the poster of our first all-women's pay-per-view, Evolution. And I just know it's so special. But before we go, what advice do you have to the women who are trying to come up through the ranks and one day have their WrestleMania match?
I just want to point really quickly to Monday Night Raw, Becky Lynch and Lita winning the women's tag team championships. You know, the two generations side by side, Becky being so inspired, so influenced by Lita, and then having this incredible moment getting to win the tag titles beside her hero. For the next generation, I would again say, dream big. Don't put any limits, no glass ceiling in your dreams, because we're watching these things unfold. I'm sure if you told Becky that you're going to be a tag team champion with your hero, you know, she would have been like, wow, you know, or maybe she manifested it because she believed that. But to the young generation, dream big, find yourself and find your niche and go get it.
I love that. Beth, thank you so much for joining us. Hope we'll have you back here soon. Thank you so much. You're amazing.
Yes. Thanks, guys. Nice to see everybody.
All right, guys. Again, that's WWE Hall of Famer Beth Phoenix. Again, Women's History Month. We want to hear from you guys. So drop a video below explaining who your favorite female WWE superstar is and why we might feature on WWE's The Bump. So again, use that hashtag WWE The Bump. Also hashtag Women's History Month. Next week in studio, we've got Lita and Liv Morgan. So do not miss next week's episode. Say it with me, Matt and Ryan. We're making Herstory.
Herstory.
Yeah, Herstory. There we go, everyone. Thanks. Thanks so much for joining us. 30 days until WrestleMania, baby. Let's go.
I'll get the chairs ready. We need a lot more for next week.
Yeah, I'm going to have to fill it in. Yeah.
Yeah.
See everybody.
All right, guys. Thanks again for watching. Bye.